This is a new old song. Are you glad you're here this morning?
Amen.
I couldn't see you. I'm going to turn around. Are you glad you're here this morning?
Amen.
Are you glad you're here this morning? If you know this, sing it with us. It's an old song.
Amen. Y'all sit down for just a minute. How many's thankful that he's all they need today? Amen. When they thought that they had it all together, and then the world happened. And then things in their life just began to fall apart, and they found that when everybody else, like, man, I'm going to encourage myself here. When, like David, when he looked over here, nobody was there. And over there, Paul said, and nobody was there. He said, I looked behind me and before me, and nobody was there, is what David said. But then Paul said it like this. He said, but I realized that when everybody else had left me, he's always been there.
Amen.
I'm thankful today that I have somebody who's with me. Amen. We're going to do something a little bit different. I'm sorry, choir. Y'all had a plan. Y'all had a preparation. But I got to look at a man's face over here, and I seen the squirm. Amen. Glory to God. I want him to come tell you what's on his heart.
Amen. So I got two things I want to say this morning. 2 years ago yesterday, I gave my heart to the Lord right here in this church. And Mike and Chris were here that night, and they tried to explain some things to me, and I went, okay, and I didn't have any idea what they were talking about. No idea what was going to happen in the future. I had no clue what was going to happen. But I have come to this church for a little over 2 years now, and I have sat back here in the back and kept my mouth shut. And I just want to give God praise for the things that he's done in my life, the people that he's put in my life, the changes that he's made in me. I work in recovery, and addiction is never, it is never a good subject that people want to talk about. A lot of times in a lot of places, people want to run from it.
Bless your heart.
I will not. I call them my addicts because I love them. And I'm there to serve them that I feel like. But I've been struggling with something for the past few months, and we had there. I don't know if you ever heard of the meeting after the meeting, but it's one of the most important meetings you could ever have. Whether it's an AA meeting, whether it's a church service, and I borrowed Pastor Corey and Pastor Mike and Miss Caroline one night, and told them what I was going through. And Corey simply looked at me and said, "Why does your disease have to be the only one that identifies you?" Cried all the way home, because for the last almost 3 years it's been pounded into my mind, into my heart, and into my life that I am and always will be a drug addict, that I am and always will be an alcoholic, that I will always be trash, and I am not. I struggled with walking into church on Sundays and Wednesdays and a true freedom on Thursday and calling myself a child of God and then going to somewhere else in front of another group of people and have to tell them that I am a drug addict. I can't be both. I just can't be. And I have struggled with it, and I am not fighting it anymore. I have been delivered. I am no longer a drug addict. I am no longer an alcoholic. I will not cast that over my life anymore. So if you are in recovery in here, there is a word called salvation. There is a word called deliverance. It's crazy that first song that you guys did. I almost got it marked out, the words. I was like, I'm definitely leaving now, but now half the church is behind me, so this is easier. I am a new creature, and I believe that he came and he died for us, and he rose again so we do not have to live that way anymore. Not every church is like this church. So I'm going to brag on the church a minute. I know you don't like this, and I'm sorry, but it's going to happen. I'm sorry. Because I've been to churches where their pastor was not like you. I've been to churches where the congregation was not like the people in this room. I'm grateful and thankful for this church and this congregation. I am thankful that you're my pastor. Daniel, Pastor Chris, Mike and Caroline have been with me since day one.
Right.
And sure enough, last night at like 9 o'clock,
bless your heart.
I called him, and he answers like he does every single time. And he put it on speaker, and I could hear him in Carolina, and they were 1,000% supportive. They have loved me when it's been hard to love me and to be friends with me. This church, I'm thankful that this is the church that I'm at. I think God put me here for a reason, which comes to the second thing. You just know. He just won't leave you alone. So it's been working on me for quite some time, and I've been fighting it. And even with Corey and Mike telling me everything I knew, I kept trying not to believe them, but it is what it is. I'm making my formal announcement that I believe God has called me to preach His word. And it's funny how you come up here and you have nothing. You don't know what you're going to say, and I love it. I love it, and I wouldn't trade it for nothing. I will say this. If you know someone that's in addiction, if you know someone that's struggling outside of addiction, we struggle with it, different things. It doesn't have to necessarily be addiction. There is a way out, and it is our responsibility. It is our job to get them to Him. Amen. Corey, thank you so much.
Give me every. He's all messed up. Don't know what seat he's supposed to be in. Hey, give me every neck tattoo. Every bum on the street. Amen. Everybody that the world says worthless and hopeless, we'll take them here. Amen. Because Jesus said you're to die for. He gave His life for you, so that you don't have to be the same as He found you, but that you can be different now, because He's got a purpose and a plan for your life. He doesn't stick you where He found you and keep you there. He takes you to a life that is filled, an abundant life. How many's thankful that life doesn't end at salvation? It just begins, amen? And the half has never been told.
Been told this world.
searching for answers, unsure of what you should do.
The sun where to stand in the morning, and who told the ocean you can only come this far, and who showed the moon where to hide till evening, whose words are yeah. and the same gentle hands that hold me when I'm broken. They've conquered death to bring me victory. Now I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer.
Studying this morning because the news I got last night, man, I've been waiting forever. My brother got saved last night. So, as a older brother, I want to be a good good leader to help him, you know, find the Lord. But I am a man of my word, and I keep my word. So, but the song they sang this morning, I can't follow that, man. That's just awesome news. I'm proud of you, buddy. You keep on doing it. But one of my favorite lessons, I told my brother, I said, if you ever got saved or get, you know, rededicate to the Lord, I said, I'd get up front and I'd announce it. So, Matthew.
Praise God.
Yeah. One of my favorite, and I'll leave this, I'll let Corey have it, but one of my favorite Bible verses has always been 2 Corinthians 5:7, for we walk by faith, not by sight.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. How many is thankful our Redeemer lives?
Amen.
Amen. Everything predicates on that. Amen. Muhammad is dead. Buddha's dead. Amen. Confucius is dead. Marx is dead. Amen. Locke is dead. They're all dead. Amen. What's the woman with Scientology? Can't remember her name. She dead. Amen. And eventually Tom Cruise is going to die too. Amen. Chandler Bing bit the bucket last night. Amen. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to break it to you like that, but it happened. Amen. We all, the Bible says that it's appointed once for man to live, then to die. But what separates Jesus from the rest of us is he got back up. Amen. Amen. And he got back up so that we could get back up with him. Amen. Look at Isaiah 49. Isaiah 49, I'm going to read this. We'll get into it. I'm going to do my best to be brief today. It's been a service, amen? Amen? It's been a service. Not very many times do you experience services like this. But I believe that you came to get fed today. And I'm going to do what I do. What I can't help but do every time I stand up here, I'm just going to feed you Jesus. So if you don't mind standing for the reading of God's word in verse number 1, we're going to look at the verse 7, 1 through 7. He said, the Bible says, "Listen, O isles, unto me, and hearken, ye people from afar. The Lord hath called me from the womb. From the bowels of my mother hath he mentioned my name. He hath made my mouth like a sharp sword, and in the shadow of his hands hath he hid me. And made me a polished shaft, in his quiver hath he hid me. And said unto me, Thou art my servant, O Israel, in whom I will be glorified. Then I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for naught and in vain. Yet surely my judgment is with the Lord, and my work with my God. And now, saith the Lord that formed me from the womb, to his servant, to bring Jacob again to him. Though Israel be gathered, yet be not gathered, yet shall I be glorious in the eyes of the Lord. My God shall be my strength. And he said, It is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant, servant to raise up the tribe of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel. I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the end of the earth. For thus saith the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and his Holy One, to him whom man despiseth, to him who the nations adoreth, to a servant of rulers. Kings shall see and arise. Princes also shall worship because of the Lord that is faithful." Amen. "And the Holy One of Israel, and he shall choose thee." Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for being so good to us, Lord. I ask you, God, that you would meet with us this morning, that you would do a mighty work. Lord, I ask you, God, that you'd empty me of self and sin. Fill me with your spirit, because today is the Super Bowl. I said, Lord, today is the Super Bowl. And I pray that together, Lord Jesus, we leave no doubt, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. I'm writing myself a note here because I got some help. And I don't know if y'all need it, but I needed it. Amen. Look, in Isaiah 49, I need you to understand this, that you can read this and get it wrong. I've heard preachers preach it and get it wrong. Matter of fact, preachers who are way smarter than I, who's wrote commentaries. Amen. That people go and buy. get it wrong. I want to go ahead and drop some knowledge on you. This portion of Scripture is not about you. You aren't the sword. This is what's called a messianic passage. In the first four verses, we see Jesus as a lethal weapon. Amen. I mean, he's a bad mamma jamma. Amen. When you read this, you see that God has specifically designed Jesus to be a powerful war horse. Amen. The Bible says that describes him as a powerful sword, a polished shaft, that's an arrow, ladies and gentlemen, and a positioned servant. In the positioned servant, we find that he would glorify God with what he does. As a polished shaft, he would be a precision instrument of war that would stay in the quiver and only be brought out at special times for special situations. Amen. But I got a little bit messed up, amen. Miss Katrina, I got a little discombobulated on this, amen. She wanted to know, if you get discombobulated, can you be recombobulated? Amen. I'm fitting to recombobulate you today, amen. I got all cattywampus up in this thing, amen. You see, the powerful sword, amen. Jesus is a shadow in God's hand, which is his hand, which is in his hand as a weapon of action. You say, preacher, what kind of action? What kind of action was Jesus going to be as the sword? Each attribute is a characteristics of what he would work or what he does in the work of salvation. We see this defined in verse number 6 when the Bible says this, which tells us his action. It says, to restore Jacob. Amen. That's the people over there that's bombing right now. Amen. To restore Israel. To restore them. That's Jesus. That ain't your job. Amen. So this can't be about you, is it? And then it says this. I love this part. And be. Now this is where you should get a little messed up. Because I know who I'm talking to. I know who I'm talking to. And I've looked at your faces and I've seen your demeanor. I know how you talk and I know the size of your nose. Amen. And know that the first part ain't applying to you. But the second part says this. It says, and be a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the end of the earth. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know about you, but I'm thankful. Listen, I'm thankful that I may not have got in through the first group. I may not have been with the first covenant, ladies and gentlemen, but I'm thankful that I get to be on the last covenant. Amen. The first covenant excluded me and said, because of who I am, because of what I've done, because of how I lived, because of the way that I walk, because I have not been chosen, I could not receive salvation. But because of the second covenant, amen, glory to God, because there was one who came down off of the throne in heaven, gave his life to die for me, because the sword came down and the power of God was manifested on earth. Ladies and gentlemen, no longer shall we be separated from God. No longer shall we be excluded from the promises of God. But because of Jesus Christ, restoration takes place. Change happens, ladies and gentlemen. Woo, glory to God. And the Bible says in verse number 7, he chose us. Y'all ain't happy because you're chosen? Amen. I believe every Chips Ahoy cookie gets excited when I eat it because I chose it. Amen. Y'all need to get some Chips Ahoy in you. Amen. Let me answer this question for you today in two parts. The question is this: how does Jesus complete this action? I don't know what's going on here, but I turned the AC on this morning. It's hot in here. So somebody fitting to feel hell. Amen. How does Jesus complete this action? Number one, if you're writing this down, it's by acting as a separating sword. By acting as a separating sword, a sword of separation. You find this in Matthew chapter 10. If you want to roll over there, that's fine. If you want to listen, that's fine. But in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus sends out the 12 disciples. He says, I want you to go out there and I want you to preach the kingdom of God is at hand. It's available to you. You can have the kingdom of God. Go preach it. Go preach it well. Go preach it hot. Preach it to them. He said this for them. This is what Jesus would say in verse number 32. He says this, whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father, which is in heaven. Now, here's what I want to get to today. This, listen, so that's why he gets his sword out. And look at how he wields the sword. Think not that I'm come to send peace on earth. I am not come to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. I got all kinds of illustrations that I'm filtering out right now. Amen. A man's foe shall be they of his own household. Jesus is a sword of separation. This separating sword would divide the non-believer from the believer. Those that choose him versus those that choose him not. But look at how he separates, the place in which he separates at. He said, son and father. Mother and daughter. And I don't know why he said this, but maybe he looked around and was like, man, there's something going on in here. There's something stinks in here. A mother-in-law and daughter-in-law. Amen. That's weird. I mean, y'all don't read, y'all, like, why did he exclude son-in-laws and father-in-laws? Maybe after he got, somebody, no, I'm not going there, Miss Nancy. Don't you take me there. I love mine. Amen. But you have to consider the context of the text. Jesus is talking to the 12 here. He ain't talking to you and me. He's talking to those who grew up in that time. He's talking to those who understood the familial connections that took place. Ladies and gentlemen, every moment from the day that baby was born, it had a rite, a ritual, a sacrifice, some type of service that it had to do. It had to go through festivals and dinners. It had to eat this way, talk this way, walk this way, act this way, dress this way, memorize this scripture. Memorize this scripture. And it's from the very moment of life that child had, they didn't get to choose. They had to be religious. So you say, preacher, what happened? He said, I'm going to come in and cut down the middle of all of the religious exercises of your life. No longer is the religious services of your life going to control you and bind you, but I'm cutting these things out so that you can now have a relationship of freedom and peace and joy and happiness. And your mama ain't gonna like it, your daddy ain't gonna like it, your brother ain't gonna like it, but ladies and gentlemen, it doesn't matter what mama thinks or what daddy thinks. All that matters is that you choose Jesus for yourself. Because, ladies and gentlemen, for a moment, growth was helped. But over time, growth was hindered. We had a bush in our yard years ago, and it was a nice-looking little bush, and it was a very fruitful bush. I don't like fruitful bushes. Amen. You say, why? Because they end up all over the yard. And you're just going down the road. Y'all never done that before? You know, you get on a hillside weed eating, you got to change your string 15 times because you just, when the Lord said, be fruitful and multiply, it listened. So we, you know, I see this bush over here and I'm like, man, that bush is starting to look weird. Sydney said, I love the bush. She got tears on me. I don't want it to go away. I said, but it's dead. Let me take it out. She said, no, maybe if we cut it back a little bit, it'd be okay. I started cutting it back. And she said, no, it still looks bad. I said, well, glory, let me cut her out. I mean, I'm all tapped into the redneck roots here. I'm ready to just rip things out. She said, oh, good. I said, what do you mean, oh, good? I'm fitting to rip this thing out. I'm just going to take it out. She said, I found a sapling here. And she put her hand down on it, and she started moving it. She said, oh, it's very weak. And I said, what do you mean it's weak? Can we take it out too? I'm ready. Ready to go. She said, no. She said, it's not getting much sun. I said, why isn't it getting much sun? She said, because it's covered by the mother plant. Mama helped it grow for a time. But now she was keeping it from being what it was supposed to be. She was choking it out. Oh, glory. You say, preacher, what'd you do? I killed mama. I took her out. Amen. That bush, until this year, was still thriving. And then Sydney gave me permission to get rid of it too, but it's gone. But up until this year, that bush was growing because what was being denied from it, it was finally getting. And it could choose growth because it was in the presence of the sun. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there are people under the sound of my voice that have been serving their mommy's God. You've been serving your daddy's God. And you've never, listen to me now, you've never chose Jesus Christ yourself. You may grow for a moment, but you'll only reach so high. If you're ever going to get to reach the height in which you were created to reach, you have to get in the presence of the S-O-N and start growing on your own. He said he's a separating sword. Oh, but how many know that he's also a surgical sword? Hebrews chapter number, chapter number four, we find that something special here. Jesus is called by another one of his words. This is one of the words that God gave him. We know it because when John was trying to illuminate Jesus to the believer and the fact that he was there in the beginning, he said it right there in John chapter 1. He said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So we know that Jesus is the Word. Now, what does the Word do? Look at what the writer of Hebrews says in verse 12. He says, for the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and joints and marrow, and a discerner of thoughts and the intents of the heart. You see, Jesus is a precision instrument. He doesn't just come in to cut off things, but he comes in to cut things out. Let me say it again for the ones in the back. Amen. He doesn't just come into life to cut some things off so that you can grow. But he comes into life to cut some things out that was keeping you from growing. When I was 27 years old, I was in the summertime. I would work while I went to school. Would work as an elevator man with my dad. I was his helper. I carried his tools. He loved it. I loved it too. Because I got paid really good to carry his tools. Amen. Just, you want a wrench? How about two? Amen. It was nice, but I learned a lot from him. Well, one day, he didn't tell me. It was right after lunch. He said, we're going to the doctor. I said, why are we going to the doctor? He said, we're going to the doctor. He has skin cancer. He's had it off and on, and he's had to have things removed. He said, we're going to go to my doctor, Dr. Wood. And he took me, and I'm like, okay, I'll just sit in there. He said, I said, you want me to have Sydney pick me up? He said, no, you go with me. We'll go home together and everything. I'm like, okay. So I'm sitting in the waiting room playing on my cell phone like all you guys do. Amen. While the preacher's preaching, playing on my cell phone. I'm just liking it on Facebook. Well, say amen in here. Amen. Yeah. That's just tomfoolery. Amen. But so we're sitting in there, and I'm just having myself a good old time. The door opens and says, and my dad goes, come on. I said, like, I'm thinking we're about to beat Dr. Wood up. And I get up, I'm like, let's go. You know, you mess with my dad, we go, I don't care what you got in there. I got more. Amen. Yeah. And he said, I get in there and we're sitting down. I start getting nervous. The doctor sits down. Dad says, pull up your sleeve. I said, why am I pulling up my sleeve? I'm like, okay, I'll show you my muscles. You know what I mean? He goes, look at his arm. And he points right here. And my dad never even told me what was about to happen. So this joker gets out this little measuring device, holds it up to this thing that's been on my arm since I was born. And Dad's over there describing, apparently my dad paid really close attention to me growing up, and I didn't know it. He said, it started like this. He said, in the last year, it went like this. And he said, oh, my, we need to do something about this. And I'm like, yeah, you found out I got insurance. I'm just a summertime employee. I'm going to be paying for this all year long. I mean, like, so He goes, all right. They did it right then and there. Didn't even make an appointment. Like, they haven't even looked at my insurance card yet. I did all that. I signed the forms on the way out. They took me in the back room. They strapped me down, shoved some stuff in my arm. I'm sitting here. I didn't get out of bed thinking I was having surgery. It chose me. I didn't choose it. So he starts cutting. It'd take me an hour to get this cufflink undone. My fingers are made of sausage. It don't work like that. But right here, there's a scar about this long that I didn't ask for. But because the doctor said, I'm worried about that spot, we need to take that spot off, I was like, okay, sign me up. He took me back there, he cut it out, and he said, I'm going to send this off to get looked at. I said, so now I'm asking questions. I wasn't asking questions before. I said, why are we going to send that off? He's like, I got to find out if it's something to worry about. So 2.5 weeks later, apparently that's how long it takes to find out if it's something to worry about. They call me. I'm sitting on top of an elevator with my dad. They call me. I should have handed the phone to him because he was asking questions for me to ask them. And I said, hello. They said, this is so-and-so from so-and-so. We called to tell you. The doctor sent that, specimen off to get looked at, and it was precancerous. I hung up the phone. I just heard cancer. I said, Daddy said, I got cancer. My dad was like, he said, now, it's very important. What did he say? He said, something about pre-cancer, but really, that's just cancer, right? He said, no. So we looked it up on my phone. And man, that's the world we live in. And y'all all do it. Don't act like you ain't on. Y'all's all been medical professionals. Amen. Y'all get on the Mayo Clinic every chance you can. WebMD, you're like, I got the cold. I got the Rona. I'm broke down, my back hurts, my head hurts, and it's like, you probably got this, and you're like, I'm dying. I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, man, I should have been done 15 minutes ago. I'm thinking, man, well, Dad, what does that mean? We read it together. Precancerous means that it has the possibility to become cancer. But the last thing that lady told me is, he said he wanted you to know he got it all. Amen. Something I didn't know I needed out of me. Hear me say it again. Something I didn't know I had. And I needed out of me so that I could be the healthiest me that I could be. A man who was wiser than I spoke a word that made me get cut on. Ladies and gentlemen, the reason why you read your Bible is because you ain't smart enough to realize that you got cancers running through your body. There's people under the sound of my voice that need to open the word of God because there's a root of bitterness flowing through them right now. You cringe at the thought of an individual, and it's keeping you from being happy.
That's right.
Oh. Someone said something about you 10 years ago, and you're allowing it to continue to control your life today.
Right.
You will never be free until you let the Lord Jesus come in and cut that out. Yeah. It'll hurt, and you'll have a scar, but you'll be healthy at the end. Let me give you this last. Let me show you this. Let me conclude this. Let me run this down. Let me get this over with. Amen. Jesus is the sword of salvation. He separates us from dead things that makes us or keeps us from growing and being alive. He knows exactly what we need and what he needs to take out, what he needs to cut off. He knows it all. And I know there's people sitting here that you've been a know-it-all for a long time. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm, preacher, that's right, that's right. But here, you know, over time, I found this to be true. Over time, and then you start getting wise and start doing your own thing. Now, if you haven't been listening, you need to start listening right now. David, in the book of 1 Samuel chapter number 17, you find him fighting Goliath, don't you? When he come before Goliath, he saw Goliath with his spear in his hand, his sword on his side. He saw him in all of his glory and power shaking himself. And he declared, you come to me with a sword and a spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. And we see David as he defeats Goliath. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm thankful to report to you that I've had some Goliaths in my life. And at the power of Jesus Christ, they have fallen. But sometimes I get used to his power. Did you know that as he's operating under the power and authority of God in his life, that he would go over and pick up Goliath's sword? He would take Goliath's sword off of his side and he would cut Goliath's head off of there, operating under the power of God. God gave him permission. Now, if you fast forward to 2 Samuel chapter number 21, or 1 Samuel chapter number 21, you're going to find that he's on the run. Saul has scared him to death. He's fleeing for his life. He comes to the temple. He comes to the man of God, the priest, and he says to him, "Do you have a weapon here? Give me a sword. Give me a spear. Give me something to defend myself. I'm left helpless here." The same one who said, "I work and fight under the power of God," says, "Give me something to fight with." You know what they said? He said, I've got Goliath's sword over there." His mind began to run back, but it only ran back to the power of the sword. It did not run back to the presence of the Lord. So he grabbed on to the power of the sword again and tried to fight the battle on his own. Did you know this? That out of fear, you will learn who you grab onto. The fears of your life, the chaos, the confusion, the scary moments of your life was put there to show you who your God really is. Where you believe power lies. When I graduated high school, there was this girl named Andrea. I can't remember. I know her name. I don't understand why I know her name today. But it popped up. Weird. Well, I asked her if she wanted to go to a movie with me. Well, I used the Zach Morris logic of dating. I'm going to take her to a scary movie. And I'm going to get her nice and scared so that she jumps up and cuddles with me. Amen. Strategery is what George Bush Jr. says. Amen. Yeah. Brother Dusty, we were sitting in there watching Freddy versus Jason. And I didn't know this, but this girl was crazy. She loved it. And I'm sitting here going, when's she going to jump over here? I'm the guy here. Why ain't she like getting closer and being like, "Save me, Corey"? It was because she wasn't scared. And I said, I dropped her off early. Amen. Now I'm seeing Alan Jackson in my head. I'm so sorry. Settle for a burger and a grape snow cone. Dropped her off early, but I didn't go home. Sorry. Y'all's preacher's so saved today. Y'all knew it, though. So I dropped her off, and I never called her back. We could still be dating today. I wouldn't know, because I never called her. I didn't even let my door open on AOL for her anymore. Amen. Just anytime she said anything, I was done. She didn't jump. She didn't jump whenever Freddie come out with, She wasn't the one. She didn't need me. So I moved on. And I found the prettiest brunette She come walking into Fairhaven Baptist Church. The doors opened. Behind a fog machine started rolling. And she became the queen of my single wide trailer. Amen. Yeah. I loved her. I love her. I love her. We got married, and about 6 months into it, I just got me a gun, or brought my shotgun and my rifle up to the house and had it laying in the corner. And we letting there watching TV, and we hear thump, 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 thump. I'm like, what was that? She said, somebody's trying to get in the house. And she grabbed me, Dusty. And I said, she's the one. She grabbed onto me. I said, don't you worry, honey. If he's out there, I get him. I went out there, my boxers on, and a wife beater. I had, yeah, man. I had on my Walmart boots, amen, with the tongues untied like that, just flopped like this while I was walking out there. Looked like Cousin Eddie coming out through there. Amen. Had my shotgun. I come around the house and went, looking for what was out there. You say, preacher, why'd you do that? Because she grabbed onto me when she was scared. And I come out ready for war because she grabbed onto me. I'm thankful that I have a God that every time I'm scared, every time I'm in trouble, every time my heart hurts, I can grab onto him. He gets out his soul. Amen. Glory to God. He gets it all out. He said, I'm ready to go to battle for you. Ladies and gentlemen, I know that some people's going through some things today. I know that you're going through some hard situations. Let me ask you this. Are you grabbing on to Jesus? You are here not because you think it's a good idea, but because God puts you here today. Some of you ain't never been here before. It's not by happenstance that God put you in this building today. It's so that you can choose Him. And He can cut some things out of your life. So that you can grow. Why not grab on to Him today? With every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm asking you to step out today and grab Jesus. Grab Jesus. If you're here today and you never accepted Him as your personal Savior, grab Jesus. If you're here today and you have some, if the doctor told you that you've got some kind of diagnosis, some kind of hard situation, grab Jesus. Maybe you're here today and things aren't going so swell in your marriage. Grab Jesus. Maybe you're here today and the banks are calling, the debt collectors are calling, the bills are coming due and you don't know what to do. Grab Jesus. If you're here today and you've got something going on, it's time to grab Jesus. Let me ask you this. There's so many people under the sound of my voice, either in the building or watching at home. Let me ask you, are you saved today? Have you called on Jesus? Have you grabbed Him? You know, He chose you. And He says, if you choose me, I'll choose you in front of my Father. You're here today and you say, preacher, I want to raise my hand in testimony that if Jesus comes or I should die, I'm ready to meet Him. I know I've been saved. Here's my hand. Thank you. Thank you so many people. Maybe you're here today and you raise your hand and say, preacher, I don't know if I've ever been saved. But you know what I'd like to know? I'd like to know that me and Jesus are together. Here's my hand. Here's my hand. Amen. Maybe you're here today and you say, preacher, will you pray for me that I'd always grab onto Him in every situation of life? Here's my hand. Here's my hand. When fear comes, preacher, pray for me that I grab Him. Amen. Let me invite you to do this. I don't know what you're going through. Only you do. I invite you to come down to this altar and grab Jesus. Don't grab the carpet. Don't grab the preacher. Don't grab the church building. Grab Jesus. I wonder if will you come? This one's come. How about you? Won't you come? Won't you come? Grab Jesus. People's moving. You ought to move too. Amen. Grab Jesus. Grab him so he'll go to war for you. Grab Jesus.
Surrender. Oh, to Jesus I surrender. To him I freely give.
Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for being so good to us. Lord, I ask you that you continue to work in our hearts. And we'll continue to give you glory and praise because it's not of us. It's all of you. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hope you enjoyed church today. Before we turn it over to you, right?
Caroline.
But she ain't even here. To Brother Mike. And Miss Caroline, I do want to remind you, trunk or treat today at 5 o'clock. And men, for the food baskets, we're supposed to do cake. Next week, the next couple of weeks, we're going to get together and figure out what all we need and do an emergency list to make sure we got everything we need for those food boxes going forward. Yes, ma'am. 19th of November, that's the week. Yep, the week before Thanksgiving, that's when it's due. So just go ahead and do it and bring it to Jill. Amen. And then you're done. But I just turn over to Brother Mike. Nope, Caroline. Yeah, he'll come talk to you for a few.